Hello and welcome to another video. So unless you have been living under a rock for the past month, you probably know that the Russian army began an offensive on the Ukrainian territory. Due to that, the Ukrainian citizens that have taken place into resisting this offensive will be in need of personal protection as to minimize the casualty. And same with the non-combating civilians that just happened to be trapped into the combat area and that just doesn't want to be shredded into pieces if some explosion happen. Because the issue with using like Russia does a lot of armored fighting vehicles, a lot of tanks and a lot of artillery, is that you often do a lot of collateral damage. So it costs a lot of civilian lives and those people might want to live. I mean, so the however the main issue is that those citizens don't necessarily have access to modern protection to keep them alive. Stuff like we'll focus on the helmet of this video, but stuff like Polish WZ-2000, Ukrainian Kaska 1M, German Schubert 826, French F2 Spectra, they don't necessarily have access to those. However, as a lot of ex-Soviet countries, they have a huge stockpile of old steel helmet, like SSH 40, 60, 68. Therefore, they might have access to that. And even though those helmets provide a decent protection against direct pistol shots, they lack protection against very small high-velocity fragments, which will be the main focus on the main thing they will need protection against. Because most civilians just want to stay alive and don't want to be shredded to pieces just because they happen to live here. And those who fight only want to defend their home. So, and this video will therefore focus on how to upgrade said old steel helmet in order to give them a decent amount of protection against small high velocity fragments. Fortunately for us, in the 2000s, the Russian army had something similar. They had the 6B14, which was a modernized SSH-68. And so, we'll take inspiration from that, and I will in this video focus on how to upgrade an SSH-68. The same principle of upgrading should also apply to the SSH-40 and 60, with the small difference that the 40 and 60 have slightly less empty space on the inside to play with. So it might limit the composite kind of upgrade, but at least the steel one and the external one should work fine. Step 1. The rivets. Generally, on most military issue helmets, the different components tend to be assembled by rivets. It has the advantage of being very simple and sturdy, but the issue with it, is that it requires tool and work to be removed, which make modification, repairs, maintenance harder than it would be for the average guy, than it would be if screws and bolts were used instead. I will, for example, show on a basic, brand new SSH-68, you can see there are rivets. The components are assembled like that. While on one of the SSH-68 that I modified, I used bolts instead. Bolts and washers. Because it will allow me, if something needs to be replaced, to make easier replacement. Will therefore, as the first step of modernizing an SSH-68, work on removing the rivets, of getting rid of the rivets, which will allow for replacing, dismantling and reassembling easily the different components. The first step will on the first step on getting rid of the rivets will be to first grind them, grind some material from them. I will recommend for that to use either an angle grinder if you are confident in your ability to grinding material accurately, because you need to be aware of two factors. The first being to not grind the steel of the shell, and second, to not overheat the steel, because while the rivets themselves are both destined to be sacrificed and on top of that are made of mild steel, the shell of the helmet is made of hardened steel with a hardness above 500 Brinells. And if you overheat the steel, you will mess up with the heat treatment, which means that the steel will become softer and weaker. And you don't want that to happen, because it means you will diminish your protection. So you want to be aware of that if you use an angle grinder to get rid of the rivets. This is why I personally, for my modification, used sandpaper like this, which is a very rough grit. It's like faulty, which is a very rough grit, because usually when people want to polish stuff, they take a higher grit, like 120 up to 1000, which are very small and fine grains. Personally, I did the opposite. I took very big, rough grains with a grit of 40, because it allowed me to heat the material very quickly. And with that, I basically grinded manually the rivets, because as you can see, the rivets are dome shaped. The rivets, at least their part that is on the outside, but same for the inside actually, the rivet head is dome shaped. So you want, with the sandpaper, to grind it until it is flat shaped. Because first, you will have less material to get rid of later, and second, you have a flat surface. And once the rivet surface is flat instead of dome, you will be able to take a center punch, which is basically a hardened steel spike, and a hammer, and you will tap on it in order to make a small dent on the surface of this flattened rivet. And once you have this dent, what will happen is that you will be able to use a drill. Because without the dent, the drill bit will try to go everywhere and it will be an issue. While after you have put a dent into the rivet, the drill bit will get stuck into this dent and will stay in place. But to make properly the dent, it is necessary to have a flat surface, not a dome or a round one. This is why it is necessary to first grind down with the sandpaper the rivet head to make it flat, so that you can put the dent and then you can use your drill bit. And then with the drill bit, you will simply pierce, you will dig into the rivet head. Beware, however, to regularly look first for the heat. Like if the thing begins to get hot, you will need to take a pause and let it cool down. A small tip that I use quite often when I do that is to put a drop of cold water both on the to put a bit of cold water both on the area I want to drill in and on the drill bit. And when I see the water evaporate, it indicates me that there is some heat, because as you know, water evaporates approximately at 100 degrees Celsius, which is already quite hot. It is not yet hot enough to kill the heat treatment of steel, but it is already hot, so it will indicate you that you need to cool down. So I put some cold water on the area I want to pierce a hole in, and I put the tip of the drill bit into cold water and I pierce. And when I see the water evaporate, it indicates me I need to take a pause to wait for the whole thing to cool down. And then I can re-put some cold water and redo again. And so the second thing to be aware about when digging into the rivet is to beware to not reach the steel of the shell underneath. Because while the rivet is made of mild steel, so your drill bit will easily dig into it, the shell as I stated previously, is made of hardened steel, which means that if the drill bit reaches the shell, the drill bit will be confronted to a much harder material, a material that is almost as hard as the drill bit, which will cause the tip of the drill bit to get dull, to get blunt. It will no longer be sharp enough. So beware of that. Beware to regularly make a pause and look how deep you have dug into the rivet head. And once you have dug at a certain depth, you will be able to take the center punch and the hammer and to basically tap on the side toward the center of the now hollowed rivet head, because now that you have dug enough into the rivet head is now hollowed, like it make a crater with only rims remaining. So you will take the center punch and the hammer, you will put it sideways, and you will tap to push the rim of the rivet head towards the now empty center of it. And once you have made that from all direction, the rivet should then be able to be removed. Like once you have done that, your rivet will no longer have enough material to have retention. And then it means that by putting the center punch on the center perpendicularly towards the shell at the center of this now of this rivet head that you have now screwed, you will be able by tapping to make the rivet go away. And then you will be able so to completely remove this rivet, and then you will be able to redo the same as well on the component that is held on the other side of the rivet to get rid completely of the rivet. Once it is done, it is removed, and you are now free to put screws and bolts instead. If, when removing the second side of the rivet, you bent a bit the component out of shape, since the inside component of the helmet are made of either spring steel for the four teeth of the suspension or from mild steel for like the extremity of the chin strap, as you can see, like there is laser, but there is mild steel folded underneath. And for the faulty of the suspension, I think you will see they are made of spring steel. If, when removing completely the rivets, you bend them a bit out of shape, you can rehammer them to re-flatten them into shape. Like the only part of the helmet that you will not be able to reshape if something wrong happen is the shell, because the shell is hardened. The shell is hard and it has no flexibility. Like it is a very because the steel the Soviet used to make the shell is a hardened steel, and it is a very very hard and brittle kind of steel with no flexibility at all. Like it will stay in place until it snap, because it is what they made for ballistic protection and all. So but all the other parts inside can be rehammered into shape if you deform them a bit while removing the rivet. So once you have done all of that, you will be free to put bolts and screws instead. Regarding the drill bit to use to dig effectively, I recommend to take either 4 or 4.5 or 5 mm diameter drill bits. If you take smaller ones, you will be too thin and you will not be able to dig enough material into the rivet. And if you take bigger one, you might lack accuracy on the side, like not the center, but more the extremities of the drill bit might try to dig the shell as well, which will cause the issues we've discussed earlier. So take between 4 and 5 mm diameter drill bits, and it will be enough. It will do the job. It is what I used. You will also probably notice that when by getting rid of the rivet, you will probably notice that the rivet body, not the head, but the kind of rod that is the body of the rivet, is not round diameter. It is not round profile, but it is square profile, and the hole Inside of the ACH-68 shell is also a square hole with between 4 and 5 millimeters of length, basically. So this is a bit unusual, and it might make difficult to put a big bolt or screw. So for the bolt or the screw you will choose to replace the rivet, I will advise to take 4 mm diameter ones, not bigger than that, because otherwise it won't fit into the small square holes, which will force you to redig the holes, which will be difficult and will kill your drill bits because the steel is very hard. So take between 4 and 5 mm diameter drill bits and 4 mm diameter bolts or screws. This is what I advise. Step 2, the shin strap. Given the fact that the whole helmet is now disassembled, you might want to use that as an opportunity to choose whether or not you want to keep either the simple leather two-point chin strap, or if you prefer something else, like for example a more modern three-point chin strap. I will show you. As you know, on the basic SSH-68, the chin strap is a two-point, which means you have two retention points, one on each side, basically. It will go underneath, under your chin. That's it. It's a simple. It's leather. It's two-point. Since you have, after the previous step, removed the rivets and got rid of all the rivets and disassembled your whole helmet, both the suspension system, the shell, the chin strap, everything is disassembled, you can use this opportunity to have the choice. You have now the choice between keeping the two-point chin strap to later reassemble it, or if you don't like the two-point, to choose a three-point, like for example I did on this modification, which is a replica of a 6B14, where you put a three-point. So if you want to keep the two-point, you don't need to do any special work. Like if the two-point is fine for you, you don't need to do any special work about it. You will just need to work on the extremities on the chin strap, because on the extremities, you will probably notice that it makes those kind of packs here that are covered in leather. And basically, what those are is that they are a bunch of folded mild steel, very thin mild steel, with leather into it, that is like embedded into it between each layer to make the thing smooth and all. And basically, inside of this whole folded thing, you have the inside head of the rivet. And so you will have to take a screwdriver, a flat one, to kind of dismantle this extremity, to defold, to unfold the mild steel, to remove the rivet, and to put the screw and the washer, basically. And to then refold everything into place and to put into place. However, if refolding all this amalgamation of thin mild steel into place like it was originally with all the laser is too difficult, because it is a bit messy, you can have an alternative, and this alternative will be quite simple. You will take a rectangular piece of any scrap metal you can find, and you will once you have this rectangular piece of scrap metal, it needs to have the same width as the original extremity and to have twice its length. And basically, you will take this rectangle, you will fold it once on itself, so that when you look it from the side, it does a bit something like this, you know, like folded once, so that it does something like this, you see? Like that. I will show you an example with a piece of fabric, but the same apply with steel. And so, like that. And then, on the center, you will put the kind of square rings, because you have probably seen that the leather chin strap is attached. I don't know if you will see it, but here you can see it has a kind of ring, a square profile ring, almost rectangular, in fact. But basically, you have this ring. So you will take this ring and you will put it. So to show you an example with another ring, a spare one, you basically take your thing and you will basically do that. But with the original square ring and with a piece of scrap metal to do that, so that you can re-put the chin strap into it and basically be attached. If you don't manage to reassemble the original chin strap extremity, you can do that to replace, which will be a bit like the attachment point of the Polish WZ68, for example. If on the other hand you wish to use this dismantled state as an opportunity to put a more modern chin strap because you want a free point, then it will require some more work and it might kill a drill bit if you do that, so be aware of it before you want to take this decision. If you want to go for toward a 3-point chin strap, like be aware of the risk of killing a drill bit, and only do it if you have a spare drill bit that is hard enough, like one that has the kind of golden color, because this golden color is a titanium dioxide, if I remember. Anyway, it is a kind of ceramic form derived of titanium that is very hard and that is used to have a harder layer on top of the HSS of the drill bits. And so, if you have those kind of high-end drill bits and you are ready to sacrifice one, if you mess up, then you will be able to do the thing for the 3-point chin strap, which basically will consist of taking, like I need, of taking the shell of the helmet and to put it on a table, like you will put it on a table, you will block it here, either with some clamp or if someone can help you, ask this person to hold it firmly for you. And basically, what you will do is you will do some digging. You will use this drill. Once again, I advise between 4 and 5 millimeter diameter for the drill bit, and for the future screw or bolt, 4 millimeter diameter. Don't forget the washers as well, as they will allow to tighten things properly. Anyway, you will have to basically dig into the back of the shell with the extra difficulty that you will not be able to use the center punch to make a dent into it because the steel is hardened. It will be as hard as the steel of the center punch, and on top of that, the Soviet blend of steel used on the SSH-60L shell has absolutely no flexibility. This is a steel that will basically stay into place unaffected until it suddenly breaks when you will oppose it to strength. It is not flexible at all. Like it's a very hard steel with a lot of hardness and strength, but it has no flexibility at all. Like they wanted to have the maximum hardness and strength they could get, and did not care about flexibility basically. So due to that, you will not be able to put a dent with the center punch, so you will have to manually hold the drill bit. So to hold it in place, to avoid the drill bit going everywhere, you will need to hold it between your finger, which will then require you to have very thick leather glove, like the welding glove, to avoid the drill bit eating into the flesh of your fingers. And you will be forced basically to do that, to use your drill to hold the drill bit between your fingers like that, and to only activate the drill at a slow rate, at a slow pace. Not the usual fast pace to dig quickly, but there a very slow pace to have the time to control things smoothly until you have digged enough material out of the steel shell that the drill bit kind of want to stay into place. And once it feels like it is stayed into place, then you can avoid to not hold the drill bit anymore and to go full speed like you usually do. Personally, when I did this whole process to make this extra hole in the shell, like on this one, where I dug this extra hole in the back of the shell, it took me between 30 and 40 minutes to drill this hole, to to give you an idea of the time it takes, and I broke one drill bit in the process. It broke near the hand, so I could finish by holding manually the drill bit and making it turn with my hand because it was very near the hand of the thing. So basically, it is not easy, and this is why if you want a 3-punch in strap, be aware of the difficulty of doing so beforehand, before trying that. But if you are ready to go through this difficulty, you can, and basically get this hole, which will allow you to put the third point of a to put a third retention point for putting a 3-punch in strap. And then, so if you have chosen to go the route of a 3-punch in strap and you have dug this hole, you will then either have the choice to use an already made 3-punch in strap that you could have scavenged for another helmet, like for example, if you have another hold helmet that you don't want to use, or a civilian helmet of any kind, or if you have a modern helmet that is completely broken with the shell being completely crushed and you cannot use it anymore, but the chin strap is still good, you can scavenge it from there. Personally, I did use the chin strap, the 3-point from an old French F1 steel helmet, basically. And if you don't have a spare chin strap, but you still want a 3-point, you can sort of build one from scratch by using those kind of fabric strips, basically. You can scavenge them from old school bags. For example, I will put some photos if I can of basically my own school bag. And basically, you have those kind of you have semi those kind of strips that are like that, but they are black and made of nylon. You can scavenge them, and you can on top of that use some rings, like the rings like those used for keeping keys together. You know, the kind of key bearing rings that are very common. You can use those to for the system, because basically, if you make a homemade 3-point chin strap, instead of having the kind of complex plastic things that clips together, because you won't be able to make them at home, what you can do is use fabric strip and use a lot of those rings to make a double D-ring system. Because basically, I will show you like the basic kind of principle of the double D-rings. It's very simple. It has been used in a lot of stuff, and even on the chin strap of the Romanian Communist era helmet, it was used. So you have like your strip of fabric. You have the two rings here. Basically, it is held like that. And then you have the strip that want to go into there. It goes like that, you see. And then you will make it come all the way around the second ring and come back into the first ring, you see, like that. See, a bit like that. I try to approach it, and due to that, it make automatically a kind of retention. You see, it doesn't want to go except if I pull very strongly. You see, because the reason it doesn't go away is because simply of the friction and the fact that when you pull, it pull the two rings one against another, which create friction for the for this strip. So I can pull like that, you see. I can pull. It doesn't go away. And so I can then do that. And once again, you see the principle. So as you can see, it is very primitive, but it works. It works, and it allow you to make an adjustable system for a chin strap at home, with nothing more than few rings, few metal rings. Or if you don't have metal rings, you can use thick steel wire and bend the steel wire into a ring shape. So fabric strips. So basically, it allows you to really make at home very primitive systems that will still be adjustable and reliable for chin straps. I'll try to put you pictures of a helmet that I built a few months ago for a relative of mine, where I had to build the chin strap from scrap, so that you can see what it looks like. And basically, you will need to make several segments of a fabric strip. You will need to make first two small segments, one for each side, that will have each the two rings. So basically, each of those two segments will be basically like that. So a small segment with the two rings, and we'll put a hole here and to basically for them to be boltable on the side, and each of those two will be on the side of the helmet for the side retention point. And then what you will do is you will put a third small segment that will only have one, like that, only one that will be on the back, on the retention point on the back of the shell. And then what you will do is that you will do three more segments that will be long this time. One long that will be the longest that will go from the two side points and that will go come under your chin, and two other long that will come around this long one. So those two other one will come around and will be basically sewn like that. You see, they will come around this front one. And they will then come into the ring of the back, and they will have the two double D ring system as I described you, as well as coming through the ring at the back, because those two pieces will basically be the part for the rear part that will hold against your occipital region of the skull. And then you will have a last piece that will be very short, a short segment. That will basically be fixed on the front part towards the center. That will be sewn to it to just be a part for being like a chin strap, like I will show you. Imagine that this part is the front part and this is the small add-on segment. We basically add it like that and like that, you see, and you will sew it together. And you have now a kind of improvised chin cup, you see, like that, and it will kind of hold on, you see. This is the way, for example, if you look, it is made of some military helmet, like it was made like that for the chin cup, like on the old Polish WZ93, for example, and some other stuff like that. So basically, with this whole method I describe you, it will of course require you to stitch a lot. You will have to do a lot of stitch work, so it will be long and it will be long, and also it will be kind of boring to do it because you will have to do a lot of stitch through thick fabric strip. But it will allow you, with only fabric strip and steel rings, to build yourself an adjustable, a fully adjustable 3-point chin strap. So something modern with a good retention and stability if you want to go to a 3-point, basically. And then once you have to do that, basically, once you have done that, so either chose the 2-point and made it so that it can be reassembled again, or once you have made the extra hole and built the 3-point, you will be ready to go to the next step, towards the third step. You will not reassemble your new chin strap that soon, because before reassembling your whole thing, you will need to make the protection upgrade, which was the kind of center part of this video that we'll get into in a few seconds. Step 3, the protection upgrade. This is the core of the video, the core of the modification, the kind of important part. This is also the part where you will have the widest array of different possibilities, as what kind of protection upgrade you will do will depend first of your need. It will also depend of your materials, the materials you have access to, the tools you have access to, the amount of time you have before you, and the weight limit you have. Because not all humans are equal, and some humans will be able to carry a lot of weight on their neck, and some no. So, due to that, you will have a certain amount of possibility. We will explore several of those possibilities in this video, but it will not be the complete list of all the possibilities you have. It will only be the possibilities that I personally judge to be the more efficient, the most effective, basically, at increasing the protection. It is worth noting also that regarding the weight budget, that the basic SSH68, so the non-modified one, the one in its factory condition, is generally between 1.1 and 1.3 kilograms heavy, depending on the size, because as all Soviet helmets for the army, there is three sizes. So between 1.1 and 1.3 kilograms of mass for the basic one. So keep that in mind. And it is also generally recommended to not go above 2 kilograms of total mass. Except if you think you will only have to keep to wear your helmet like 1 hour at a time per day or something like that. But generally, it is recommended to stay under 2 kilograms. This is why, if you look at the helmets, the standard helmets of most armies in the world, the generally most of them are between 1 and 1.5 kilo, and the ones that are above 1.5 kilo are already rare, and none is above 2 kilo. Like all the combat helmets that are above 2 kilo are generally made for things like specific units for specific operation, like Navy SEALs, Spetsnaz, stuff like that, you know. So not the regular Joe. So for the regular people, I would not advise to go above 2 kilograms, less if possible, actually. Because when you wear a helmet for a long period of time, especially if you cannot take it off for multiple days, you will feel like the weight on your cervical, basically, on the vertebrae of your neck. So after some time, it will physically kind of hurt. And this is not something that you can train a lot for just increasing the strength of your muscle, because you don't have a muscle that act as a rigid thing to keep the from vertical weight. The vertical weight, even if you have muscles, will be taken by your vertebrae. So it's not something you can really increase just by hitting the gym. So basically, try to keep the total weight under 2 kilograms. So, regarding the protection option, first one that will be kind of out of this list, because but it will be, I still talk about it because it's very easy to do, very quick to do, and very cheap to do. However, it has issues, it has a very low durability, and it is not balanced. It will be to simply take up some ceramic tiles, some duct tape, and basically duct tape some ceramic tiles on some area of your helmet, basically. Like you take some duct tape, you take some ceramic tile, the floor tiles, not any ceramic, the floor tiles, and you will just duct tape that into you on top of the shell of your helmet, which will basically blunt the fragments and slow them down so that the steel can catch them. This is not a method I would recommend unless you have no other choice, because it is not balanced and it has very low durability. Very low durability, like even if you just bump your head, you might break the ceramic and it will be done. So it's only if you have nothing else you can do. So after this method, which is basically what we will consider like the last resort method, we'll have other ones. Among those other ones method, the proper method, we will say, the one that won't be broken if you just fall, basically. The first one and easiest one will be to cut a piece of sheet metal. It can be steel, it can be aluminium, it can be stainless steel or anything else that has sufficient flexibility to be bent. So no hardened steel, because you won't be able to bend it unless you are good at forging and you can kill the heat treatment, bend and reheat treat it. But that's out of the scope of this video. This video is more for helping the average Joe do the thing. So basically, you will use some cutting pliers like those, which basically are nothing more than giant scissors, to cut a piece of scrap metal. any scrap metal that is ductile enough to be bent by hand. And you will cut a piece of scrap metal with the good shape and size, and basically you will put it on the top of your shell of your helmet. Generally, if you are in a situation, generally if you are in a situation where you are most likely to take impact towards the front, put it on the front, especially if you are fighting. If you are non-fighting, well, you will need a more of an all-around protection. But basically, you will cut a piece of scrap metal. You will adapt it to the area of your helmet you want to reinforce. You will drill holes in it and will basically add it on top of the shell. And this piece will then be fixed to the shell when you will reassemble everything, and the bolts will go through both the shell and this add-on piece. Basically, making something very similar to the World War I era Sternpanzer that was used by German troops back in the day, by machine gunners and snipers of the German army during World War I. So the trench warfare, the Great War, basically. The advantage of this method is that it's still relatively easy to do. It won't require you a lot of accuracy. You basically just need to cut a piece of random scrap metal and to bend it. And to drill the holes at the proper area of the metal and add it, slap it, and basically it will be bolted, and that's it. It's very simple. It has, however, the issue of being very unbalanced and quite heavy. It will be heavy and unbalanced, so keep that in mind. It will also add some external bulk to the helmet. You can also make a variation of this method. To basically, instead of making a kind of Sternpanzer that will be on top of the shell of your helmet, you can use a variation of this method to make a front mask to protect your face from the fragments. By for example, giving it the plate kind of side arms that will reach the side holes of the shell, you see, like that. And basically make something that is T-shaped with like going from there to there and then having a main branch going like that. And basically, with doing that, you can make a front mask that will keep your face safe from the fragment. If you don't want to increase too much the weight of your helmet, and if you think the basic steel, hardened steel of the helmet will protect you enough from what you are exposed to, but you don't have anything to protect your face, you can, instead of up armoring the helmet itself, make a mask to protect your face with this method. And since the helmet, like all Soviet era helmet, have a kind of big front lip, you will be able to use that to let a piece of the plate rest on it, so that it doesn't fall out all the way, you see, which will allow you to only have to link your plate to the shell from two point, the side point of each side, you see, like we'll only have to link it one side, like that, and then to avoid it from going too much towards the bottom, it will rest on the lip. So that's a simple way to make very simply either a Sternpanzer or a face mask. Very simple. Whether it is this method is kind of heavy for the Sternpanzer one, and yeah, you guess it. The second method will be technologically similar to the third one, to the first one, but it will be a bit harder to do. And it is a method that I did. It will basically be the kind of same method as a Sternpanzer, but instead of being on the outside of the helmet, it is on the inside. It is on the inside this time. And why do it on the inside? Like I did on this one that I modified, you see? It is a SSL68 that I modified, basically, and I did that it's add-on on the inside. And why do that? Because first, the added material is inside the shell rather than outside, which means that you will have less surface. Because when you want to add a certain thickness of material outside of something, you will have to cover more surface than if you add it inside of something. So, it diminishes the surface I had to put, which allowed to save weight. The second thing is that the steel I had access to is very flexible. It is a piece of steel that comes from a French F1 steel helmet. Those helmets has a kind of steel that is very similar to the Hadfield steel, which is very flexible. So basically, it made more sense ballistically to put it after the Soviet steel than before. Because when you want to stop a projectile, it makes sense to make sure that your hardest layer is the first layer that the projectile will encounter, because it will blunt the projectile more, which will then spread the projectile material into a wider surface, which will make the job easier for the following layers. This is the two reasons why it is more optimized to do it inside rather than outside. However, doing it inside required me to be more accurate because I had no possibility to make it rest on the lip. So, on top of having the two side holes to fix it to, I had to fix it to those two upper holes of the suspension. So, I had to hammer down my piece of steel into the correct shape to be for the four holes at the same time and to have some kind of to be properly curved on both sides, a double curve from the top, because it had to be curved on a vertical perspective but also on an horizontal perspective. So I had to make a double curve with my hammer and to stay accurate with the holes. So it was very difficult for me to do this. It required me a few days of work, but I finally did it. So basically, it is still a variation of the Stirnpanzer method, but it is harder than the first one. So if you want to go using this method with steel, you are ready to put the amount of workforce into it to be more optimized than just slapping on the outside, you can do that. That's what I did on this one. Due to the fact that it has less mass, it allowed me for this one to stay at 1.7 kilograms for this one, despite the fact that the added steel is 1.2 millimeter thick. So basically, on the front, I have the 1.2 millimeter of hardened Soviet steel, and then 1.2 millimeter of a more flexible French steel, which give me 2.4 millimeter of total steel. So I got a good front protection, and it is still unbalanced towards the front, but not as much as if it was on the outside. Anyway, this is like the second method, which is harder than the first, but it is harder than the kind of hobo method we had earlier. But it is still possible in a relatively short time compared to the follow-up method we will see. Because those methods we've talked about are methods that will directly depend of how much work you put into it, and you can achieve it quickly if you put enough work into it. The follow-up will be harder and longer to do, and we'll have some waiting time. So the two last options we'll see will both include the use of synthetic fibers. And basically, we'll have a result similar to that. Similar to this one that I modified. Basically, why use the synthetic fibers for those two last methods? The reason is that for stopping fragments, synthetic fibers are very weight efficient, especially in conjunction with a hard steel layer in front of it, which the SSH-68 had. So basically, going the synthetic fiber route is literally what the Russian 6B14, and so known as SSH-68M, was about. And this will be what I inspired. This is basically the two last method I will talk about for protection upgrade will be directly inspired by this old Russian method of the 2000s. So basically, what we will do is that you will have to find some synthetic fiber fabric. You can find it, actually, it is easier than you think. You will have several possibilities. We'll have two methods for using synthetic fibers. We'll have the kind of dry method and we'll have the resin method. For the dry method, you will need a synthetic fiber that can work as being dry without being trapped into resin. You have synthetic fibers that do that. For example, you have nylon fabric that you can easily scavenge from old sport bags and school bags. Like sport bags and school bags are often made of a very thick nylon fabric because they will be exposed to a lot of friction, so they need a solid fabric. You can use those. You can also use some polyester fabric from very thick curtains. I will try to see if I have a piece of those curtains here. No, I don't. But basically, I will try to post some photos, some pictures. Basically, the thick synthetic fabric. Avoid organic fabrics like cotton or jute because they are not very efficient at stopping projectiles. They are not good in terms of ballistic strength. So avoid cotton, avoid denim. Use polyester and nylon, thick polyester and nylon fabric. This is the one you want to go to. You can scavenge them from old school bags and stuff like that. And you will basically scavenge this fabric and make pieces of fabric that can cover the inside of your shell, the inside of the shell of your helmet. So you will see what size matches the inside of the shell of your helmet, and you will cut. You will basically cut a kind of slice of this fabric, so some piece, to cover that. And you will, if the piece kind of fold on themselves too much, add some cuts and stitching, so that it makes a cap that covers properly the inside of the helmet. And then you will add multiple layers like that, until you haven't put enough of them. Because you need to be aware to not put too much, because you will need, after your helmet is modified, I will use this one as an example, you will need to not put too much, because you need, once the helmet will be reassembled, to have enough space to easily put your finger between the suspension and the shell. You absolutely need that, because this empty space will be the space needed for the suspension to deform and absorb the impact force. If you don't have this empty space, the shell will directly enter in contact with the suspension, and so your head, and will directly transfer the blunt impact, which will result in serious trauma. So you don't want that. You want to have that void, at least one finger of void between the suspension and the shell. At the very least, if you can put more, but that is the minimal you will need. That is like the least amount you need to have a decent absorption of impact. So keep that in mind. So do not put like that thickness of synthetic fabric. If you do that, it won't. You will have no absorption left. Don't put too much. Generally, you will probably not be able to put more than something like 15 layers. Like 15 layers of ballistic fabric is probably the most you will achieve, unless the fabric is very, very thin. Like it's something, if it's a very thin fabric, maybe you can put like 20, maybe even 30. But if you have a good thick nylon fabric, 10 to 15 layers would probably be the maximum you can put without being too thick. And so you will add those layers. And once you have all those kind of cap layers that are good, that fit inside the shell and cover the inside properly, you will stitch them together. You will stitch them together. And once they are all stitched together to make a kind of single cap, you will then be able to fix this cap on the inside of your shell. You will use either glue or resin or duct tape, anything you have that will hold it in place. And once it is held in place on the inside of the shell of your SSH-68, you will then be able to basically hold the shell in place. You will hold it in place, and you will begin to take your drill, put the drill bit tip inside of the hole of the steel shell, and then to dig into the synthetic fabric layer you have put, to remake a hole on the proper place into the fabric cap, so that later you will be able to reassemble everything. And so you will do those holes into the fabric at the good spot. This is why I recommend to go from the outside, Because if you go from the outside and make your drill bit enter the hole of the steel shell, it will mechanically align itself with the hole of the steel shell. There is no other way around it. And so once you have done all your holes, you will be good. If when doing so the drill bit push against the the fabric and dislodge the fabric from the shell, you will then need to have a second person helping you and basically pushing against the fabric with like a wooden stick, for example, not with their hands, to avoid piercing their hands if the drill bit go through suddenly. So with a small stick, a small wooden stick, and to push the fabric against the shell to avoid the fabric dislodging itself from the shell. And so once you have done it, and once all the holes are done into the fabric cap, and the fabric cap is still held in place properly against the inside of the shell, then you will be able to reassemble everything properly and all. So that's kind of the gist of it. The other method, the last method, which will also involve a synthetic fabric, will be probably the most complex one. It will be the longest one to do, but it will be the one with the most ballistic efficiency. Basically, it will be the one that is literally the method used by the Russian for the 6B14. It will involve using resin to lay the layers of fabric together and to keep them in place on the shell. So you will have two choices of resin first. You will have two choices of resin. You can either have polyester resin or epoxy resin. Polyester is cheaper, it's easier to find, but it's slightly weaker than epoxy. And on top of that, the polyester resin has the issue of dissolving polyester fabric. So beware, if you use resin, do not put polyester resin on polyester fabric. If those two enter in contact, the polyester fabric will dissolve itself into a messy goo, basically, it will melt. So if you use polyester resin, use nylon or fiberglass. If you use epoxy resin, you can use polyester. That's the thing you need to know. So with this method involving resin, you will have so those two choices of resin, and you will have different choice of synthetic fabric. You will have polyester, nylon, or even better fabric, like aramid, UHMVP, stuff like that. But it will also, as opposed to the dry method that could not use fiberglass, because fiberglass as a dry fiber don't really work well and put glass shard everywhere, which is dangerous. If you use it inside of resin, it's fine, and so the method with resin will allow you to use fiberglass. However, be aware to use fiberglass cloth, not fiberglass mat, because fiberglass cloth, like for example the fiberglass from a welding blanket, is a literal piece of cloth. It has a weave. The fibers are aligned, they are orderly, they are inside of weave. They are doing their job. Inside of a mat, they are just random piece of fiber kind of thrown together, and there is no consistency in the material, so it is weak. It doesn't have the tensile strength you need. So don't use fiberglass mat. If you use fiberglass cloth, like from a welding blanket or something like that. Okay? And so basically, with a composite method, you will do your pieces of fabric like with the previous method to make a kind of cap that goes inside the shell, and then you will lay a bit of resin, like for example with a blotch, for example, I think with like I don't have the good word for it, but anyway, you will lay down some resin on the inside of your steel shell. A thin layer of resin on the inside of your steel shell, and then you will add the first layer of fabric. You will lay it down, you will press on it with your hands. You should wear gloves to avoid putting resin on your hands, because the resin will otherwise stick to your skin for days, literally days. So wear gloves and press on the fabric to make it stick properly to the steel shell. And then you add a bit more resin of this fabric. You add the next layer of fabric and you press it, and so on and so on. And once you have done that with all the layers you needed of fabric and resin, you will then put a plastic bag. You will lie on a plastic bag, like the shopping plastic bag you have in supermarket, on top of that. And then you will take a spare helmet, a second helmet, preferably one size under the helmet you are modernizing, and you will press it. You will press it with like either weights or clamps or by your own hand to basically compress the thing so that the layers of fabric which are now soaked in resin will be compressed between, at one side, the shell of the helmet you are modernizing, and the other side, the outside of the helmet that will be a spare helmet, which will force the fiber composite to have the shape, the proper shape. And the plastic bag is here to avoid the resin from sticking on the shell of the spare helmet, because you don't want to ruin the spare helmet. You want to be able to take it off after, and so. Basically, you will do that. And once the compression is done properly, you will have to wait between one day and one week, depending of which exact resin you took, for the resin to harden, to become solid. And once the resin is hardened, once the resin is solid, you will be able to take out the spare helmet, to take out the plastic bag, you will cut the extra material from the rims, and you will then be able to, like with the previous method, take your helmet, take the drill, drill inside, going through the holes of the steel shell, and dig inside the composite to basically make the hole into the composite. And once it is done, you then can reassemble everything. You can reassemble the piece of your helmet, and that's it. And once again, be ready to not put too much thickness, because on my first attempt at making this one, this replica of 6B14, I actually did a composite shell, but I did put too much layers, and basically the shell was too thick and I could not really do anything out of it. So I had to remove the entire composite shell and to make this one from adhesive cloth instead. So beware to not put too much thickness. And if you are not sure about the thickness, try to make samples. If you are using the resin composite method, make a sample with the amount of layer you wish to put and see the final thickness of this sample. And adjust until you have a sample that is not too thick, and then put the same as this sample, because otherwise it will be too thick. So beware of that. This is an issue to be aware about. And this is why this method is only the last one I talk about, because it is the most complex and the most long method. So this method will only be relevant for you if you are like in a position where you have access to all the synthetic fabric, to the resin, and if you have tools and time and all. The other methods are simpler, as you could see. I went gradually from very simple up to more complex method. Step 4. Verification. Setting up suspension, and the last bit. Now that you have applied all the selected modification and modernization on your helmet and reassembled everything, it is time to first proceed to the test to see if everything is as supposed. You will therefore proceed to set up the suspension, so tying up the 5 laces on the SSH68 suspension, both the central lace for the vertical suspension and the 4 side laces for the horizontal suspension. A total of 5 laces to put everything into place and to have like the whole suspension set up for your own skull size and shape. And then once you have set up everything of that, it is time to try, basically. So to put on the helmet on your head and to see if if the weight is not too much unbalanced, if you can still wear it without the thing being too unbalanced, if the thing stays stable enough on your head, or if it just falls like crap, to see about that. And also time to see if you still, after having reassembled the whole suspension and all, if you still managed, like I told earlier, to put, if you still have the empty space, if you still have like one figure of empty space between the suspension and the shell. Because you will need this space, because basically without this space the shell will directly transmit the impact. So you need this void to have the space to play with for the suspension. You need to see all of that. For example, I will just give you an example when wearing it myself. So this one is a basic 68, it's a basic one, but basically to see if the thing is still stable enough, if you can look down without the helmet falling off your head, if you can look up without the helmet falling back on your shoulders from your head, to see if you can put your head on side without the helmet falling on the side, and see if the weight of the helmet is not excessive, and if when putting your neck towards the side or the front or the back, if it hurts your neck or not, and to see if the weight is excessive or not. A little reminder from the previous part, try to stay under 2 kilograms of total weight, and keep in mind that the SSH68 on its basic version is between 1.1 and 1.3. So, which means that the total weight budget you have for your upgrade will be between 700 and 900 grams maximum. It will be the maximum weight budget you will have for your upgrade. So keep that in mind. And see if you still have also with the empty space the impact absorption. So put the helmet on properly and then basically use the palm of your hand to slap on the helmet from pretty much all directions, from the front, the side, the back, the top, to see if you still to see if you feel or not the shaking, like do it like strongly, and see if you feel the impact being transmitted to your skull or not. If you only feel the shell moving and you don't feel the impact in your skull, it's good. If you only feel that the shell is moving and you don't feel impact being transmitted to your head, it means that the helmet is doing his job. AKA the shell move and the absorption is the impact is absorbed and your skull doesn't have to take on anything. But if you feel if you feel some impact being transmitted to your skull, it means that something is wrong and you will therefore have to look up what is wrong, if you have enough space and between the shell and the suspension and some things like that. Because if something as weak as the strength you as a human being can pull on the shell is enough for you to feel the impact on your skull, it means that the impact from fragments coming from an explosion will do infinitely worse. Because you have to remember that we as human beings, generally with a good punch, we can put few dozens joules of kinetic energy. Something like the high velocity fragments from like an explosion are contained in the hundreds of joules of kinetic energy. So you add 1-0 basically. Just take that into account. So if just by slapping with your own strength the helmet, you already feel the impact going into your skull directly. It means that against something 10 times the strength, you will feel something bad. So keep that in mind. You need to have a good enough absorption so that when you hit yourself the shell, you don't feel the impact on your skull. And so once you have set up everything and once you do not feel an impact when you slap on the shell, you don't feel any impact, everything is fine. If the thing is not too heavy, if it's stable enough, if it's not too uncomfortable, if it doesn't hurt the neck when you look on the side, or if you put your neck toward one side or another, and things like that, if the impact absorption is good, if everything of that is good, then congratulations, the upgrade has been done successfully, and then you will be able to do the kind of finish. What I mean by the finish, it means that you will be able, if your screws are a bit too long, to take a hacksaw and to cut the extra length from those screws, because the screws need to not be too long, otherwise you will have something that will scratch against things in your surrounding, that will get stuck in your surrounding, you know, it will cause issues. So you want to cut, to not have too much extra length on the screws. And once it is done, you will then take some sandpaper and grind at the head of the screws to be able to, how say it? To make the head of the screws smooth on the torch, to not be sharp, to not cut yourself, basically. And once that is done, you will be able to take a plier or a wrench, basically, depending on what screws you choose. Either, so for the nut side, you will take a wrench, and for the inside side, for the head of the screw, you will, depending of if you choose a flat one or an hexagonal one, take either a screwdriver, a flat screwdriver, or you will take a pliers. By pliers, I do not mean cutting pliers, I mean holding pliers, like those, you see, to keep it tight. And basically, you will hold the head of the screws like that, and with the wrench on the other side, you will tighten up, to tighten the screws or the bolt properly, because you do not want the helmet to disassemble itself when on the field. So you will tighten everything up properly after having done the cutting and the smoothering, like the grinding on the screw, basically, to get something like that, basically, you see, similar like that. So you don't have a lot of excess length, and it's smooth on the touch, you don't cut yourself. Do not forget to use washers as well on both sides of the screws, both on the outside and on the inside. I will show you, like here, you can see here how it is made. I recommend, if possible, to use flat tip screws as well, because you won't have a big, it will be smoother on the touch, so less chance of harming yourself, you see. And to use then a screwdriver, and you see washers. Use washers, because the washers will allow you to spread the pressure on a wider surface, which will allow you to tighten up a lot the screw without damaging anything, which will be better. And so, once the screws, the excess length is cut, once it has been grinded down with the sandpaper and it is smooth, and everything is tightened up done properly, you will then retest everything, the second test, to see if everything is still fine, if nothing has been messed up during the process. And then, if things are still fine, if nothing is messed up, then congratulations, the helmet has been modernized, it's done, everything works, and you can now put the paint if you need to be more stealth, to be recognizable by your own, to avoid a friendly fire kind of situation. Especially as, according to some video I've seen, I'm not sure if they are true one or if they are out of context video reused, but I have seen some videos that, according to the sources, were about the Ukrainian conflict. It might be false, because as you know, we have a lot of misinformation from both sides of the conflict currently. And people who want attention, who want fame, and who take any video from any other conflict and put them in and pretend it's Ukrainian conflict, so that's something a bit messy. But according to some of what I saw, apparently some pro-Russian forces still use old steel helmets. So therefore, once all the modernization are done, once everything is perfect, a new helmet has been successfully modernized, think about the proper painting to avoid the friendly fire situation, because, well, you don't want to be you do not want to have some useless casualties, basically. So take care of that, and that's it. Your helmet is now ready, and will therefore provide you with a more adequate protection for the current situation. So thank you for having watched this video. And if you have either any question about the process I've described in this video, I tried to be the most accurate possible, but if something is not accurate enough, or if you encounter an issue with a material, if you have an issue, don't hesitate to leave a comment and to ask a question, and I will try to answer my best to the comment. At least if I get the notification, but I will try to look and to see if you have an issue. I will try to help about this. And yeah, basically, thanks for having watched, and goodbye, and see you in the next video.